How do you make an incision on left side to extend the VST? Sometimes for double CT operation, we need VST extension during the procedure. So,
in
this is a VST?
Yeah, this is from the.
Yeah, VST.
This is on the left side, yeah.
Actually, the conduction is here.
Yeah, so you prefer not to.
Conduction is here.
Yeah, my.
So make an incision this side.
Yes. Yeah? I prefer not to go superiorly.
Yeah, superiorly and more posteriorly.
Yeah.
Yeah, make an incision here.
This is another specimen of the corrected TGA. You can see this is the aorta, and this is the pulmonary artery transected. You can see it here, and this is from where it was transected. So that's the cut in here. So normally it would be like this, and this is the mitral valve. Okay. So in case you want to cut across the annulus, the only possible way without causing any damage is to go, your incision comes in obliquely, mm-hmm. and then you go posterior mm-hmm. into this area. Yeah. And that gives you about maybe 5 to 10 millimeter enlargement, which, you know, as I mentioned, could be quite adequate for CCTGA because you can be left with some gradient that would be okay. You don't have to relieve the obstruction 100%. And the other thing, it's always also to avoid the conduction. The generally in these patients, the aorta is very large, so you can always gain an easy access to the VSD through the aortic valve.
Yes.
And then you'll be working through the right ventricle, and in that way you can avoid the penetrating bundle, and the incidence of heart block is much lower. Yeah. I have not done Nikaido in a CCTGA, and I think it would be very, very difficult.
Very dangerous, I think.
Yeah, but, the VSD closure, if the pulmonary is okay, you don't have to use a conduit, it's just regular. And then you do the atrial switch and the arterial switch, yeah. But, of course, the difficulty becomes if the pulmonary artery is stenotic or arthritic, and then you have to combine like a Rastelli with the atrial switch, yeah. The atrial switch part is not difficult. It then becomes very difficult if you have to enlarge the VSD. But, if you always go, kind of away from the conduction tissue, you can always enlarge the VSD, yeah. In the, like, opposite direction of the conduction tissue.
So in this case, where do you resect to enlarge the VSD?
Yeah.
If the VSD is not required, this is VSD.
Mm-hmm.
No VSD.
There's another specimen.
This is the VSD.
Yeah.
This is, where is the aorta? Yeah.
This is the aorta. Yes.
This is the
aorta. Through the
VSD. Always, this part away from the. This is the tricuspid valve. Mm-hmm. Tricuspid valve, and that's the VSD. It's this part.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. This part, maybe conduction, in danger. This part, maybe.
Mm-hmm. The pulmonary valve is up.
Yeah, this is
up here. So, all this broad can be resected safely. You can just leave the very superior rim.
I see.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you said you are like saying this like this one, like this one?
Like this.
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes. Yeah.
You can, you know, you don't have I to see. Go, you know, yeah. To go up front, yeah.
Yes.
To go
so up close here, to the, yes.
So close to the mm-hmm. aortic valve.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, most of the time actually, you know, with the large aorta and etc., you know, you actually just, you know, be some muscle bundles and etc. It's not exactly like, you know, you just make a clear pathway. It's not exactly like enlarging the VSD. Yeah, because most of the time the VSD is quite of a good size. Yeah.
Mm, I see. So you think they don't need the enlarged VSD?
Not very much. Most of the time. Yeah. Yeah.
So I think also very dangerous.
To enlarge the VSD.
Yeah,
it is, but as you know, the incidence of heart block in corrected TGA is very high.
Yes.
And spontaneous
right.
congenital heart block occurs in about 30% of the patients with corrected transposition, and you know, some really estimate as even it's an ongoing. Yes. You know, it's an ongoing risk all as the patient, you know, like survives.
Yes.
Something like, you know, maybe 1-2% per year a chance of developing a heart block.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes,
so even a patient who's fine, you know, 10 years down the road might develop, you know, heart mm-hmm. block with no
so
surgery, with nothing.
I think
yeah.
If you have the patient with this heart, so in this case, just in this case, I think it looks like somewhat restrictive VST as we see the from the left side.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, so you have to, I think if we make an anatomic repair, so this patient had a double switch, sending laterally. So in this case, you need the breast enlargement is necessary or not?
In this particular heart,
yes.
I think it'll be probably necessary.
Necessary, yeah. I think so, yes.
Yeah. But you know, there is one thing, as you know, kind of experience accumulates, it's very interesting that in current literature, mm-hmm. like if you're looking at, you know, 2016 and 2015, the double switch or the anatomic repair long-term results are not as good as we
content?
Not as good as we think it is.
I see.
Okay,
I see.
Particularly if you have to use a conduit or if you
I
have
see.
To.
I
yeah,
see.
Yeah.
I see.
And you know, my estimation that we will be doing less and less, you know, anatomic repairs, particularly in older patients.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe in the infant, you know, it might be good, but you know, maybe in older children, you know, it might not be as good as, you know, we think, and in particular those patients who require left ventricular training. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. But I think in this case we don't need ventricular training because
of course, yeah,
yes,
but the VSD, yeah.
So in this patient, if this patient coming to you in infancy with a as I say, regional hemoglobin, regional saturation, so how do you do that? Do you do the in infant the double switch?
Yes, I think you know, if you want to plan to do it, I think it would be better to be done within the first 2 years of life.
2 years of life.
Yeah.
So you
yeah.
in this patient, you
yeah.
do the
selling if I decide to do the double switch, I'd mm-hmm. rather prefer to do it in patients who are younger, you know, like around 2 years, you know, yeah. in the range
some,
of 2 years of age.
Some surgeons are doing this on this patient like this, so doing Fontan.
Correct. You know,
is
some, you know, you know.
It's because this patient either atresia or puma stenosis?
Correct, yeah. And actually, if you look at the early, you know, up to about maybe 6-7 years,
mm-hmm.
the Fontan are better.
Fontan are better.
Less re-intervention, you know, and their quality of life is better. But of course, you know, we know the limitation of the long-term limitations of the Fontan. So, you know, beyond, you know, 10 years, you know, the Fontan, of
mm-hmm.
course, you know, probably can start to, you know, some of them fall off. And maybe, you know, the biventricular repair would be at that time better. But the thing is, you know, it's the corrected you know, it's the CCTJ that has the problems, you know, not other, not other, you know, like if you have a difficult double outlet right ventricle, you know, and you go for a biventricular repair, it's not like, you know, the CCTGA. Yeah. So actually there was a presentation from Toronto SickKids at the AATS last year, actually showing, you know, that, you know, the corrected, you know, the anatomic repair is not as good as we think, you know, and I think I'm sure that that paper should come up, you know, this, you know, shortly in the journal.
The other interesting thing is if you have a CCTGA with a left ventricular, you know, with the outflow tract obstruction, you want to go on a sending resterly pathway. Even in that cohort, you would prefer to do them early.
Yes.
Right. Yes. Okay. Because there's a lot of thinking among the cardiology fraternity, especially in the younger kids. They are not more worried about the left ventricular outflow tract, you know, the reconstruction of the right side, but they're more worried on the sending part of it, because in smaller kids they feel that the amount of tissues that you get, you know, maybe whether there's a higher chance of getting.
But I think, you know, between 2 and 4 years is very, okay. Is very reasonable.
So that's very encouraging. That's very encouraging.
But you know, the thing is, you probably have to, for optimal results, you probably have to do it before 4 years. You know, I don't think that you should wait beyond 4 years. You know, probably 4 years is a good enough size to do whatever, you know. And you know, the conduit, it's inevitable. You know, you'll have to change the conduit. Anyway. You'll have to change the conduit. There is no way around it. So and actually, it's very interesting because I did find a paper that was published in the journal, I think, in the 90s, from Japan.
Right.
That they specifically looked at patients with single ventricle, and looking at the ventricular mass, myocardium, you know, like muscle and etc. And clearly, in that paper, they demonstrated that 4 years, beyond 4 years, the ventricular function starts to decline.
All right.
Okay. And that's why the recommendation, you know, is not like what Fontaine, you know, in their initial recommendation. That it should probably, a completion from then should be done before 4 years of age.
One more question with surgical correction, descending resterly tract. Usually, if you look at the anatomy of the pulmonary arteries and the aorta, the pulmonary artery is more on the right, on the right hand side. Sometimes you have a decent sized main trunk of the pulmonary artery. So, when you're going to place your conduit, would you shift that to the other side of the aorta to bring it onto the left, or you just go across?
It depends. You know, I think if the alignment is good, then etc., I would just leave it to the right. You know,
to the right, okay.
With the you know, and try and protect, you know, the back of the heart, you know, for reentry.
Okay.
And occasionally, if you know, because sometimes you don't really have room on the left side. Actually.
Sure. Sure.
But if you have room on the left side, you can always shift the pulmonary artery and do the anastomosis on the left. Yeah.
So go case by case.
Case by case, yeah.
So actually, we have three cases. We cannot decide at infant age because it's very difficult to decide. So we perform the PCPS at 6 months. And at 3 years, around 3 years, we did the thoracic operation at the time.
3 years.
Yeah,
and I think, you know, between 2 and 4 years is a reasonable size. But if you have a patient, you know, like somebody, say 6 months of age, okay, got a good VSD, good pulmonary artery, and good, you know, aorta, I would do the double switch at that age, close the VSD and do the,
So you in a setting of a VSD. With no outflow tract obstruction, you want to do the operation.
Yeah.
So you never do a band to prime the.
No, no. With the VSD, But even, you know, in LV retraining, in patients with CCTJ, we don't have guidelines.
Sure.
In terms of the LV mass or whatever, you know, we go exactly like we do with the DTGA, but we're not sure if it's correct or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Actually, we have a couple of patients that we retrained, you know, very good LV mass, very good, etc. And they, you know, like six, one of them actually 6 months only, and the LV started to show, you know, signs of failure. Yeah.
Thank you.